We all want life. We want a quality of life that really matters. Followers of Jesus wanted that too, so they left everything and followed him. They watched him love the outcast, confront the religious elite, and proclaim the kingdom of God to anyone who would listen. And then they watched him die. But just when all hope was lost, they watched him rise again. And somewhere along the way, they discovered what they'd been searching for all along. They discovered abundant life. So what about us? We've become exhausted by temporal things that promise meaning and purpose, but in the end, deliver nothing. What we really want, what we really crave, is life. The very life that Jesus walked out of the tomb to invite us into. How do we discover what we've been searching for all along? May God give us eyes to see.
We are in a series simply called Jesus. And when you look at the image behind me, some of you very quickly see, yeah, I see J-E-S-U-S. For some of you, like, man, why are those lines on the screen? Some of you just have the ability to see Jesus in every experience, and you're kind of in tune with what he's doing. Others go, man, it's hard to see Jesus or to understand what's really going on. Even when you look at these portraits of Jesus and people trying to understand who Jesus is, sometimes it can get lost. Like, who is this guy? What's really the purpose behind him? So many people have opinions and ideas about Jesus, and in this series we're bringing it back to the basics, that Jesus is all about. We've been looking at what the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of Jesus Christ. And you can see that in the tomb and the cross. And listen, don't forget about the ascension. Do we have that? The next slide, Aaron. You have the tomb and the cross and the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And listen, the ascension part, I think the church does a good job in general talking about the cross and Easter and resurrection, but we don't do a very good job talking about Ascension Day. We're talking 40 days after he comes back to life. Crowds see him, his disciples see him, and then in 33 days, we're going to have Ascension Day, where he literally sat on the Mount of Olives, and he ascended into heaven to show us and the world, hey, I am still alive. The truth of the matter is that all of us have to answer the question, is who is Jesus? All of us have to answer the question, who is Jesus? Do you remember when Jesus was with his disciples? They went up to Caesarea Philippi. And at Caesarea Philippi, even if you go today on the stone wall there, you'll see all these markings of different gods and what's going on. And Jesus asked them a question. You remember the question? He said, who do people say that I am? Who do people say that I am? And do you remember the disciples' response? Some of them go, oh, people say you're like John the Baptist. You know, John the Baptist came on the scene and he spoke with great authority as he spoke for God. Some go, oh, no, they think you're Elijah. Now remember, Elijah had what? He called power down from God, that he had the power of God behind him. They knew that Jesus had the power of God. And they go, no, some call you Jeremiah. And Jeremiah, of course, was the weeping prophet who had such great compassion on people. But that was just a setup question, wasn't it? Because the real question, he goes, okay, but who do you say that I am? And all of us have to answer the question, who do you say Jesus is? Now, if you remember that context, Peter says, you are the oily one. You are the anointed one. You are the Messiah. And Jesus said, Peter, you didn't get that from flesh and blood, but you got that from my Father in heaven. And upon that confession, upon that rock, I'm going to build my church. We've been going through a 1 Peter study. It's Tuesday nights at 6 p.m., and I'm happy to lead that. And if you're interested in that, just come, and you can be a part of that series. But I love what Jesus does. He gives us such great clarity in one statement when he said what? I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. He wants us to have complete clarity on who he really is. Now, if you're a Christian, there's an excitement about Jesus because we know with Jesus, it's possible. With Jesus, it's possible. Why is it possible? Because Scripture teaches that he's what? He's the fullness of God. If you ever wonder, what would God be like in human form? They call him Emmanuel, God with us, that we can see God's mannerisms and how he would live and lead on earth through Jesus. And so because he has the fullness of God, he's not lacking anything. And what? He's come to reconcile all things, that he is a reconciler. Most divorces get checked, irreconcilable differences. We couldn't figure out how to be compatible. We couldn't figure out how to live. And Jesus says, through me, you can be compatible with God. You can have a relationship with God through me, that I will reconcile all things to myself. And I love that Jesus has that ability. Saturday morning, I'd come up early to church to get ready for a wedding I was officiating, and the women's brunch was going on. And Deanna and the team do such a great job with that. But the women's brunch, it's like, it's a hard no. No guys can be around. You know what I mean? It's like, so I'm kind of back here. I'm peeking around. And all the women's events start the same. Food, laughter. But they all end the same. Everybody's crying. I don't know what happens, but there is a moment and everybody's crying, right? What's happening? Things are being reconciled, you see? That when you talk through life, there's a reconciliation that happens. They go, you know what? I can understand this and I can understand this. And sometimes that brings you joy and sometimes it brings you tears. And I got to leave from here and I got to officiate a wedding, a couple in our church. They've been coming to this church about 9 months, and both of them, this is their second marriage, and I know their story. And I really thought it was over for them. And God didn't have any more good for them through a loss of life and circumstances, right? But what happened? God is reconciling things, and to see those two come and before their family and God and to be in marriage, it's such a beautiful thing when God restores and he reconciles all things for himself. And then I got to leave there and go to a wedding shower for my niece, Autumn and Colonel, getting married in a couple of months. And at that wedding shower, what's happening? See, Autumn's singleness and Colonel's singleness, it's being reconciled. It's being brought together, that God has a plan for them to be together, that the two shall become one. God is always in the ministry of reconciliation. That's why we love this place so much. And that's why many of you follow Jesus, because you've seen him restore and redeem anything. But not only is we get excited about Jesus because everything's possible, it's also personal. Jesus is not just like this distant person or that doesn't want to know us or get to know us. In fact, it's just the opposite. Paul would say what? Man, I consider everything a loss for this what? Surpassing what? Of just knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. I got a little bit discouraged one day this week, and a friend just said, hey, how can I help you? And I just said, no, I just need to spend time with Jesus. That really the time alone with my personal Savior who knows me and knows it, I just need time with him. Because I know spending time with him, I'll have a proper perspective and I'll get his truth and I'll enjoy his fellowship. That's what I need. I appreciate it. But what I need, what? I need my personal Lord right now. I just need to go spend some time with him. What's the point? Jesus plus nothing equals everything. And everything minus Jesus equals nothing. That when we come down to that, Jesus, a personal relationship is the most precious thing that we can have. And if we have that and nothing else, we have it all. So Jesus tells us that he's the way, the truth, and the life. Week one, we looked at I am the way, that he's the way in, the way out, the way back, the way forward. Last week, as we looked at the truth, we looked at the truth of the resurrection, the truth that this is all a rescue mission, the truth of his return one day, the truth of the reckoning of those that are his and not his, and the truth of a relationship. Today, we're going to talk about his next statement, which he says, I am the life. I am the life. Now, this is a two-part message, okay? Part one today, I'm going to give you a more theological background, and then next week, it's going to be a lot more practical as we look at it, abounding and abiding life. So part one today, part two next week. The first board game, it's actually the longest continually published game with its known design. It's called The Mansion of Holiness, 1800 to 1926 design by Mr. George Fox. First ever board game, longest continually published in the history of the world. And of course, someone's like, man, if I'm going to do a board game, I'm going to do it about life. And he called it the Mansion of Happiness. Now, what takes place is there's 66 squares or spots that you go around, and you get at the end to what? This Mansion of Happiness. And of course, the 66 represents all the books of the Bible. And the end goal is what? Is to be with Jesus in the happiness. They call it the Mansion of Happiness. And if this is all based on the text we've been learning, John 14, that, hey, what life is about is being able to navigate who Jesus is in the truth, and at the end, you get to spend forever with Jesus, right? Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you. Of course, this was developed as the awakening's happening over in Europe, and again, great run, 1800 to 1926. Now, a man by the name Milton Bradley played this game. He goes, this is good. I want to make a game. Now, he called his the checkered game of life. It was still, it was different. It was a little less spiritual, but it still had moral things. Like, hey, if you do this, you're going to go to prison and that. And you would navigate this checkered game of life. That was in 1860. And 100 years later, we now know it as, of course, the game of life. The game of life. And if you probably have this game at your house. You probably played it as a kid. They update it every decade, the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s. And we have it at our house. And we love playing the game of life. But as you play the game of life today, there is no spiritual questions in the game of life. You get to pick if you're going to get married, if you're going to go to college, what you're going to do. But there's no spiritual questions. It isn't interesting. Doesn't that happen that way? We say it kind of like, hey, life got in the way. Like if you look at the origins, this was all about navigating life. And the goal is to be with Jesus at the end. And now there's nothing about Jesus. And it happens to all of us that we can miss Jesus in the most important thing that we have. And that, of course, is the game of life. Jesus leaned over the Last Supper to Thomas, who had questions, and he was curious, and God loves curious people. He loves answering them. And he said this, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. I want to do a little background on this statement, the life in Jesus, and understanding Jesus' authority in the matter. First, we have to understand that life is the ultimate experience. That you and I are alive right now, and this is the ultimate reality that we have. Now, some of you, you had difficulty being born. And you have a story about complications, but you made it, and you're alive. Some of you have stories about accidents and tragedies and near misses and you should have died, or you could have died, or, man, I was wrong, but you're here, right? And you get to the, you're alive. This is the most reality that we can experience is life right now. Do you remember 23 years ago, the first network reality TV show came out? It was called Survivor. You remember that? And the country went nuts. They loved it. The ratings were the highest. They realized, man, people have an appetite, what? Just for real life. Put these strangers on an island. Let's see who wins. Anybody remember who the winner of season one was? Richard Hatch. You remember. Good. He then got thrown in jail for tax evasion because he didn't pay taxes anyways. The point is, I remember watching that. And it was so, because this is like, this is what? Now, real life, reality TV today, it's scripted. It's not as good. But back then, here's the point. This is real, what you and I have an opportunity to experience, that life is the ultimate experience. Now, what does Jesus say about it? First, when Jesus makes the statement that he's not a life, but he's the life, let's investigate that for a second. Let's go to John chapter 1. It says this, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things, talking about Jesus, were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Here it is, verse 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. That the life, Jesus, is what? He is unique in existence. He has always been alive. There is not anyone who's been more alive or alive longer than Jesus Christ himself. From the very beginning, he was and he always will be, that he's never died. He's always been alive. No one has more experience about knowing what life is about and being alive than Jesus. He says, listen, the scripture says, hey, I am life. I am the life. I know what life is. There's a unique in his, no one else makes this claim but Jesus Christ. Now look at Romans chapter 5, really 17 to 21. It's a great passage. We don't have enough time today to go through all of it, but in Romans chapter 5, verse 17, what Paul is helping us understand is that we look at Adam and his trespass and the death and sin that came from that and how it affected all people, right? You know the story. Adam trespassed. He went somewhere he wasn't supposed to go. God gave him everything for his good, and he said, don't go here. And he trespassed. He didn't obey. He didn't trust. And he went, and he ate. And because of that, sin and death entered. And you and I both know that when sin begins to start, it multiplies quickly. I mean, think about it. What was the original sin? Eating. They ate. They ate something they weren't supposed to. And by Genesis chapter 3, what does the Lord say? He said, I only see evil everywhere. Wow. And what happened? The wages of sin is death. And this perfect garden and world that Jesus has created is continually evil, and he destroys it. Noah and his family, eight people, get through. And guess what? Noah and his family, they still have sin, don't they? And you and I still live in a world where sin and death are prevalent. I mean, think about it for a second. Look at, we've got to figure out crime. We got to have laws. We got to have courts. We got to have judges. We got to have jails. We got to have armies. We got to have a government going, man, how do we manage all this sin? How do we manage all this sin? It even touches economics, right? In economics, it's all about work and scarcity and management. Adam, he didn't have to worry about that, did he? In that perfect world before that sin, he didn't have to work for that fruit. It was there. It was not scarce. It was in abundance. He didn't have to manage anything. But now the world we live in, it's like, man, we got there's work and there's scarcity and there's management. How are we going to figure out government, protection from the evil one? And what do we do with people who are lawless? And we live that. We've had to live in that way. This is what Scripture says. Look at it. Because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man. And much more will those receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of the righteous reign in the life through the one man, Jesus Christ. So, Adam's sin brought death to all, but Christ's death is going to what? It's going to bring life to all. See, we couldn't stop the death. We couldn't stop the sin because we're all sinful. But Christ wasn't. He was pure and he was sinless. And his one act of what? Of the resurrection and defeating death. Now he brings what? He brings life to all things. That the life, Jesus, is undoubtedly exclusive to him because he's defeated death. So he can turn anything dead into anything alive. So when he says, I am the life, we can take him at his word because he's the only one that's defeated death. And he can bring life to anyone. John 11, 25 to 26. This is Jesus' last public miracle, and it's a big one. He raised Lazarus from the dead. And you might remember the scene as he's coming up. The sisters are upset, and he says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And he asked that so important question. Do you believe this? I am the resurrection, but I also, what? I am the life. That the life is eternal. It's an upward eternal. We're all going to live forever. We're either going to get a body to withstand hell, or we're going to get a body to withstand the glories of heaven. We're all going to live forever. But he goes, if you believe in me, what? Then you get to spend eternity with me, with the Father. And it's this upwardly eternal place that's exclusive through the life of Jesus. I am the resurrection and I am the life. Now, some of you, when you think of this idea of the life, you go to John 10. John 10:10 specifically, it's a great passage and verse to memorize. He says, the thief has come only to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. And I don't know about you, but the longer I live, the more I understand this verse. I was talking to a guy this week, and he's like, man, he goes, why do you think Easter and Christmas are attacked commercially so much in our culture? It's like the two most holy days, and why is there so much commerciality and just trying to sway people from what actually happened in Christ? I said, because we have an enemy. And what does he want to do? He wants to attack life. He doesn't want people to know. He doesn't want people to know who Jesus really is and that God sent him as we celebrate his birth. He doesn't want people that he resurrected from the dead. He doesn't want people to know. So he's going to do everything he can to attack that. Do you remember, even at the birth of Jesus, the enemy hates life. Do you remember when Jesus' birth? Read Revelation 12, what was happening in the heavenlies. And then what King Herod, he said, well, kill all the babies two and under. I can't get this man. He's the Son of God. If he's the Son of God, I can't have him out there. And what? Attack life. Attack the things that matter. If you're married in here, listen, the enemy does not want to see a godly marriage. I keep thinking that that fight will be over. It's not. Kel and I are celebrating our 18th anniversary is next Sunday. And let me show you how it's happened. I'm just going to be vulnerable with you, okay? That's how it works. I said, Kelly, Can we get some time together to celebrate our 18th anniversary? This time of year is always tricky because, you know, it's always around, you know, the church or birthday, Easter, Palm Sunday. And then, you know, she's a teacher. They got testing. So it's always, I'm like, hey, can you take a half a day off? Can you find a couple of days and let's go celebrate, you know? And I said, just give me the window and I'll plan it, right? And so she gives me this 48-hour or so window. I'm like, okay. So the way I work is I want to get the most in, have the most enjoyment in the smallest amount of time and for the least amount of money, okay? That's what I'm looking at. So I'm like, hey, I just go on. And I go from Houston. What's the cheapest airfare to anywhere? Where is it at? And it was to Oakland, California. It's to a discounted airline where, you know, you don't, I don't want to say the name because I don't want people to get mad who work for Spirit, but it is like bottom of the barrel, packing a backpack, crammed in. So I'm like, okay, we can get to Oakland for round trip under $200. I said, listen, we'll fly into Oakland. We'll rent a car. We'll drive the Highway 1 to Monterey. We got a friend there. We'll hang out in the Monterey Peninsula there. And then, hey, the next morning we'll get up. We'll drive over to Lake Tahoe. It's about 5 hours. We've never been there. We'll stay there. Our flight back happens to land in Vegas like at midnight, and our next flight is at 4 a.m. It'll be fun. We'll just go get dinner somewhere, get back on the plane, and you'll be back, and I'll be back in time for work and school. And she's like, no. I'm like, what are you talking about? I said, I've crushed it. I'm getting all these things planned out. I said, it's a force to be fun. And she goes, Jason, would you please know me? That does not sound fun to me. I don't want to do that. I said, babe, I'm trying to celebrate our marriage. And she's like, I'm trying to save it. She's like, how much is that going to cost? I said, hey, listen, there's no greater investment than to invest in each other. I always think of Rick Warren. He said, you know, they had no money. They didn't have a church. And he said their marriage was in a tough spot. He goes, man, I used a credit card for marriage counseling. It changed everything. Listen, there's no greater investment than Kelly and I. But here's the truth. I am trying to celebrate my marriage, and we're fighting about it. Isn't that interesting? Like, hey, let's go spend time together, but yet in the pursuit of loving each other, we're arguing about it. And it was not a good argument, and I take the full responsibility. It's one of those, like, we're now leaving, and it's like, are we going to say I love you? Because if we don't see each other again, we're going to feel bad that was our last conversation, you know? And I think I said I love you first because I usually initiate when I'm wrong. I don't know. The enemy, church, the enemy is going to come after life. Anything that's life-giving for you, your personal time, your worship, your service. Listen, you go, man, I want to. What happens? The enemy's coming after it because he wants to kill, steal, and destroy. And Jesus said, I want to lavish you. I want to give you an abundant life. The life I have for you is not restricting. It's not boring. In fact, it's the greatest life, and I have it for you. Next week, we're going to look at this abundant and abiding life. Now, Most of that you've heard before, and you understand. So really it comes down to, what are we going to do in light of Jesus saying he is the life? How do we reconcile my life and the life, right? How do we reconcile what I think life is and Jesus saying he's the life? A couple of passages before we go. First one is 1 John 5:12. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. Could it be more plain or clear? And this message is not popular. You know that. You go share this at your workplace or your family, they'll be like, what? What is he saying? He's saying, really, your life begins when you receive and believe in the life, Jesus. That if you don't have, you don't even have a life. You want to get a life? He says it starts, what? With believing and receiving the life, the Son. That you and I's life really begins when we know the life. But look at the progression. Matthew chapter 10, 38, 39. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What are we talking about here? What's he trying to communicate? Okay, you've told me that my life really begins when I receive and believe in the life. But now he's saying, now, and this is what's going to happen. Take up your cross. Be ready to die any day. You see all these crucifixions happening? This is going to happen to me. It's going to happen to those who claim to follow me. It's coming. So just know, take up your cross. Every day could be the day if you stand for me and stand for the gospel. But he says, really, you're going to learn that your life is about losing it. When you give up your own life, you're actually going to find life. And you're going to find real meaning and purpose in me. So my life needs to be lost so the life, Jesus, can find it. Do you see? This is really learning to what? It's learning to fall out of love with our lives, isn't it? Have you seen that? This is natural. You just don't love things as much as you used to. And what happens is you fall out of love with certain things and you fall more in love with the life or with Jesus. The last, you know, month, 2 months, you know, I've been wanting to try to go and have play some golf. I'm not that great at golf, but I enjoy it, and I haven't played in a long time. And Friday, some guys invited me out 7:30 in the morning, and I went there. I enjoyed the fellowship, and I didn't play that great. I never play that great, but really not that great that day. And you know, as I was leaving, I was like, that didn't bother me. Like, there was a time in my life I was real competitive. Like, I wanted to do, like, I still want to do my best, but, like, if I didn't do well, like, it just messed me up the rest of the day, and I'm mad at the world. I'm like, man, this is ridiculous. And I was like, it really didn't bother me. And as I was leaving there, I got a phone call, and I met up with some other guys. They were playing golf. They're like, hey, you come join us. And I went over there, and I played great. I enjoyed the field, but I was hitting. And the guy's like, hey, man, you're, like, one under. And I'm like, I know, but I think I'm going to go. Because I wanted to get back as Kelly was getting out of school and Jaden was going off to the high school retreat. And I wanted to see my son off. And actually, the guy, Brandon's right back there. He's a great golfer. I will beat you one day, Brandon, but it was not yesterday. But I will be. But can I just tell you, when I was doing good, it didn't have the same effect on me. Why? Because I hope I'm maturing. Hopefully. Are we going to play this week? We going to play, Brandon? No. Look how he finishes, Acts 20, 24. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Now, wait a minute. I understand. Okay, fine. My life starts when I receive the life, and okay, I'm learning to lose my life so I can find it. But he takes this, he said, actually, what? My life has no value? The only value it has is what? It's in the gospel. It's things done for Christ. That's where my value in life is going to come from. That my value has no value outside the life. What's the point? He's saying, don't waste your life. Don't waste it. I was 20 years old, and a bunch of college students decided to get together in Shelby Farms, Tennessee. There was a couple hundred thousand of us that came, and we just came on this farm, and there were different worship people there and people preaching, and it was just one of those spiritual markers in my life as a 20-year-old and just being there. And in fact, the 20-year anniversary, I think the New York Times did a study, and they just looked at the people that attended this event, and it was just how God used that in amazing ways, different churches and people. It was just one of those holy gatherings that if you were there, you remembered. It was the very first Passion event, this one-day event, to have it, and they never did that same event again. Everyone knew, man, don't touch that. Don't do that. God was sacred. God did something special. And I remember John Piper delivering a message on don't waste your life, that I could still give you the outline to it. And through the Holy Spirit, just profoundly affected me. And there was a time during that gathering that we all laid down on the ground for a couple of hours and just said, God, it's not about my life. Whatever, if there's any gifts, it's for you. And just being in the presence of God and going, God, I don't want to waste my life. That whatever years you give us, we want to use it for the gospel. Our high schoolers went on a retreat this weekend, and somebody showed me this picture. So I guess they're doing the same thing there. I don't know. What do you think? Just consecrate yourself in prayer or sleep. I'm not sure, but hopefully it is prayer. Now listen, it wasn't prayer. You can vouch that was sleep. Listen, church, let's don't waste it. Amen? Let's don't waste it. I am the life. But I do not account my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I've received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. You know why so many people serve us around here? They've experienced the grace of God and the gospel, and it's changed them. And they go, man, if I got extra time, I'm going to go serve somebody. Man, if I can pray with someone, I'll pray with someone. If I got any extra resources, I want to give them to God. Why? Because I know what matters most is that. And the legacy I'm going to leave is going to be what? Is what's done for Christ is going to last. And that he's the author and he's the finisher of my faith. And what a privilege that you and I can stand here today and hear this message. And God wants to birth something. He wants to bring life to something. Maybe it's a ministry. Maybe whatever it is. You know it's in there. And the enemy in this moment wants to snatch that from you. He doesn't want you to experience the life. But oh, it's available to us. When we finish that board game, the life, you know, there's a winner. And basically the winner in the board game of life of just kind of whoever has the most stuff at the end, right? You add everything up, and whoever has the most money, they win the game of life. And when you're done, you put all the stuff back in the box, and you close the box. And we all know that, you know, that money was fake money, and you really didn't earn that salary, and you really didn't win the game of life, that it's just a game and the box gets closed and it's game over. And the truth is for you and I that there'll be a day when it'll be game over for us. And anything that we've accumulated won't really matter. And that casket or that box will be put over on us. And all that's going to matter is where we believed that Jesus was the life. And our legacy that'll be left will be what we've done for Christ. Not my life. No, we live for the life. Would you pray with me? God, I thank you for just helping us understand life. God, I thank you that your experience is unique in the existence, that no one's known life longer than you have. God, I thank you that you defeated death and so that you can turn anything from death to life. God, I thank you that life in you is eternal with you if we believe in you. God, I thank you for just how you want to just lavish us with an abundant life. Yeah, would you help us believe that today? That living the life through you is not restrictive, and it's the best life we can ever live. God, I pray for the person this morning who says, you know what? I'm ready to lose my life and exchange it for the life. That I want my life to really begin today with a relationship with Jesus and the life. Lord, I thank you that you take us through a process of losing our lives so that we can actually find what matters. God, I pray you'd help us just die to self and to fall out of love with the things that we shouldn't love, and in turn fall in love with you and that you are the source of the life. And God, I thank you that would you help us understand there's no value. Our life has no value. That all of our value comes that we may finish the course and the ministry that you've given us to testify, to tell people to the gospel and to the grace of God. God, I thank you for allowing us to be alive in this moment. That this is real life with you right here. Holy Spirit, challenge us to live. Call us to live. God, I thank you. God, I've never been loved like I've been loved by you. This is the best life. God, I've never been forgiven like you forgive me. Thank you. This is the best life. I've never been encouraged like I've been encouraged from you. There's no other life, Lord, we want to live but a life with you. Thank you for being so good to us. Help us trust you and believe that you are the life. And when we feel dead, we know that life comes from the life into you. God, help us live that way today. God, I pray for us this week as we work through this and we get ready to receive and look like, what does an abundant and abiding life look like? God, thank you for being the authority on the subject. God, I pray you would come and give us great life and we would know you are the life. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand? Let's sing this together.